Hey guys, it's Mark Oakley here with another episode of From the Drawing Board, and today I wanted to tell you a cool little story. But first, I have to take you through some keyboard madness. This comes with me everywhere I go. It's my little backpack, handy dandy laptop holder. It flips around and becomes a little drafting board. And so I use it in two different ways. One is if I'm sitting down, I got to get some work done. Oh, you got to check this out. This is really cool. I'm quite proud of this. Let's see. Can you see that from that angle? Yeah, there you go. Okay, so this piece of wood, dual purpose. One, it allows you to, set it up like so. So you got yourself a handy little drawing station here. But you don't always want to be drawing, and if you want to be typing, well, what do you do? So what you do is you unfold it this way, and it slides in like that. And so check this out. Because if you're a tall, gangly guy like me, if you do that sort of praying mantis pose over a keyboard, you slowly evolve into Gollum. And it messes your back up and you get headaches and you lust after power, I think. I don't want to turn into Gollum, so I came up with this thing. If you take this out and go to like a cafe or something like that, people, well, actually, they in this town they accept that I'm a strange puppy. And so they don't care. Or they'll go, "Oh, neat. I should get one of those." They never do because you got to build this bizarre or this very cheap wooden thing here. But anyway, it lets you sit down like you can take a deep breath, you can sit in your chair and you can type like a sensible adult. You're not like you get to be comfortable and your body position is an indicator of your mental position, I think. And thing is, how do you type? There's no keyboard here. All right, so enter the USB keyboard. So I have this thing, and this is one of several that I've tried. This one I got, I was like, okay, I want to get a small keyboard that will just sort of sit here, and you can plug it in into one of the USB ports, which I won't do right now because it's not necessary. And so I wanted something that was durable and small and could just throw, just toss it in my backpack along with all this kit, right? And I was hunting around, and when you're like online shopping and it's kind of late and you sort of, impulse shopping, man. They've perfected that mechanism in the, they've the social engineers. They don't need to put magazine racks and gum and chocolate bars and the little Tic Tac things. We've all, when we go grocery shopping, we've all seen that particular display. The Archies are there, and you got the Cosmopolitan mag stuff. I don't know anyone who actually impulse buys that stuff. I think we've, built up a resistance to that kind of impulse buy. But man, in the digital world, so we're not quite so resilient, right? So you're on like one of these digital, online purchasing systems, and you're looking through all the different options. You're like, there's Amazon and eBay, and you're kind of going, okay, I want to, you can sp spend quite a lot of time looking for the perfect, well, in this case, small keyboard. And, but then it's that last, 10 seconds. You've got the one on the side going, oh, that's kind of cool. This is a Japanese one. I don't know if you can see quite up close, but there is like katakana on the keyboard. And I thought, I want to get a Japanese keyboard. Won't that be the coolest, weirdest thing? Well, so and it was a lot more expensive than the next one on my list, but it was just that 30-second impulse. Yeah, I want more katakana in my life. And so, bam. And then 3 weeks later, you now own a Japanese keyboard. I was really proud of it for a while, but I don't know. It's with keyboards, especially when you do a lot of typing, a lot of writing like I do, you start to notice the weird quirks and personality, well, the personality quirks of a keyboard. Like if, you know, if you sort of you hit the shift key with your little pinky, and if you get it come down on the corner and it doesn't quite make contact one out of every 100 times, man, like, well, you hit the shift key all the time. That 100th time is like, it's like someone kicking you, or it's like someone poking you in the back of the neck. And it's just, you want the perfect keyboard experience where it's like, you know, 9,999 times are perfect, and that 1,000th time, well, you know, 10,000th time. Basically, you want as close to a perfect keyboard experience as you can get. This doesn't quite do it. It's just irritating. So I retired it. And I actually have another one, which you know, works a lot better. But anyway, this is slightly beside the point, because this keyboard over here isn't designed for that setup. This I got for a studio arrangement. I have, you know, three cameras set up, some really nice microphones. I wanted to do sort of an interview program, and I have this nice studio space. It's like that's 99% ready to go. That 100th is just like, oh, the thing poking me in the neck is like, it's just a few little tweaks and timing issues, and I'll get it going. There's going to be some cool stuff coming up on this channel. But anyway. One of the things that I was experiencing was like, you need an operator, a booth operator that can sort of switch between the cameras. And I had it all set up with, you know, one of these, you know, it's OBS, Open Broadcast Software, or Studio. Yeah. Anyway, it's a free program and that's good. But I think with free stuff, you tend to get sort of more quirkiness. Anyway, you got to use a mouse to select between your cameras. And I had this super clicky mouse, and it was that was bleeding into microphone inputs, because I wanted to have the booth operator also part of the conversation. I'd have like three people be able to talk, and it would just be you just hear clicking and hear keyboard chatter as he's sort of managing the cameras. Oh, I got to do something about that. So there's a number of different ways of solving it, but one which struck me is like, I wonder if you can buy like super quiet keyboards and super quiet mice. So check this mouse out. Actually, I'll go over to my drafting board setup here, and oh yeah, you can see on the screen the latest Star Drop is all about frogs. I'll post that one in a bit. But okay, so this is a basic mouse, and listen to the click. Now that's not super loud. The one that I had at the studio was a little bit louder. But it bled. You could sort of hear the stupid click. It was just driving me nuts, right? So I got this thing. This is a silent mouse. Listen to this one. I am pressing it. That's really, really quiet. So I was very pleased with that. And the keyboard. Well, you know what? Like a big clacky keyboard. Let's go for a comparison over here. I have a little tiny one up here. So. And I'm doing all kinds of bizarre functions to my screen as I randomly clack keys, but you can hear the keys, right? That's what it sounds like. So a silent, supposedly silent keyboard sounds like this. I wasn't as happy with that one. I wouldn't call that silent. I call that, you know, turn the volume down to 5. I almost want to return it, but I have it now. It's a really nice keyboard. I think it's going to work out well. And combined with the other solutions I have for like modulating volume or moderating volume, well, I think will work. But anyway, here's the point of the story is this. So I get the thing, and they don't tell you that it comes with one of these old PS2 outmoded ends. Like, you have to have a pretty old computer for that to plug in anywhere. I was expecting a USB plug. And I didn't, so that's just like, great, I can't plug it into the system I have. Got to get an adapter. Wait a second. I have an adapter. I know, I can picture it in my mind. It's this little thing, it basically converts from, you know, this thing, you plug the adapter into that, and it'll now be a USB plug. Ain't that great? So I'm like, all right, the only problem is I've moved twice since I got that. I'm never going to be able to find the darn thing. So whatever, you know, due diligence and all, I go through all the boxes of computer stuff that I have, and I've lightened. Like I was like, oh, some of this stuff is like from the 90s. So I threw a lot of stuff out. Like, oh, I probably got thrown out in one of those. Went through everything that I did have, couldn't find the darn thing. Oh well. Now, the point of the story is that Well, I'll get to it. I believe, as I've made clear in other things that I've written, other posts that I've made, I've been talking about this for 20 years. I believe the subconscious is extraordinarily powerful, and it is working behind the scenes if you like yourself. I think that's very important. You have to like genuinely believe that you deserve good things. And then your subconscious will go, okay, well, if you deserve good things, then I'm going to navigate the world invisibly, and you don't know what's going on up there, to help you out. Other people will look at this and say, oh, the fairies are helping you out. And so that some unseen magical force out there is assisting. And there may be something to that. I don't know about the fairies, but I think the universe is magical. But I think a lot of what happens and a lot of that magic is tied up with this hidden mind that we all carry around inside our heads, our souls, whatever it is that directs us, and that our conscious selves are maybe 5% of the whole show, that there's a much larger production going on backstage. Anyway, this is what my backstage production did. So I'm like, I went to sleep and got up and did the breakfast routine. I'm just like, man, I got to order that stupid plug thing. So I'm going to order, and I had one of these bottles of kombucha. And this one's empty. It's basically a fizzy drink, and it's full of all kinds of nutrients and stuff. That's a side story. Anyway, this is a special bottle, and when it's empty, you could take it back to the little health food store and refill it. That means the lid is important. And so I'm taking the lid off, and it pops, and it tumbles, and it goes down, it's gone. I go, damn, I need that lid. Not going to be able to get any more kombucha without the lid. I guess I could carry it home and not spill. That's not quite the same. It's fizzy too, and all the gas will get out. So I'm going, okay, damn it, I gotta go hunting for lids. So I'm hunting in the dumbest places. You see like this fuzzy stuff under the heating grill? You don't want to go in there. There's like dust and dead bugs and all this stuff. Anyway, I'm going way down behind here, find the lid, and right next to it, this thing. Hey man, it's the plug. It's that adapter that I thought was gone from two moves ago. I was like, oh, perfect. Thing is, that's really amusing, is it's the wrong kind. I need this part to stick out and that part to go in. So that's tough, and I think that's really amusing, because it's like your subconscious is like, remember that trailer for one of the Guardians of the Galaxies? I don't even know if it made it into the movie, but it was like two of the characters are in a cage, that Rocket Raccoon, I think someone else. And little baby Groot he's out there. He can squeeze out the bar. Like, okay, go get the key for us. And this little baby Groot is like, I don't know what that is. Yeah, just go. So he goes and he'll wander away and come back with different objects. Here's a chocolate bar. Here's a thermos flask. They're like, no, that's not a key. Oh, and he keeps trying, but he's trying so hard and it's so earnest. He's like the little fairy. That's your subconscious. So my subconscious went diligently and found the thing. I'm going, oh, it's the wrong kind. But don't worry, computers are complicated, dude. It's all right. Still have to order one. Anyway, I thought that was amusing. And yeah, that's good enough. I think that's enough for a silly video today. All right, guys, I'm going to get back to work. And I hope you have a wonderful day. And I'll talk to you again in another video. All right, cheers. Bye.